Welcome to the presentation of Portmanship Behind the Scenes, where we discuss kind of what Portmanship is actually doing. So the agenda is to explain what Portmanship is, how Portmanship came to be, the technical things we do and the people things, because we have managers overall, and then some closing thoughts and time for questions. So Portmanship, according to the website, is responsible for overseeing the overall direction of the ports tree, building packages and personal matters. So the ports tree is basically the source, combined source of all the packages. And in the particular, Portmanship is not the owner of all the stuff in the MK directory. And it's also not intentionally evil or tries to set policies unilaterally. But sometimes yeah, we have to kind of break some eggs. So so for example with the Python stuff, so there should be a nice YouTube video now. And if it's just an overview of an artist rendering of the Porsche tree, which an actual tree. So why Portmanship actually came to be, now I dug into the archives of Portmanship, and Kirill Ponomarev, who was of Portmanship way before me, remembered that it was to create packages for all the releases on the Tinderbox, and I'll come to that shortly. Support and retain the package utility and its predecessor in the Way system, and test all the critical changes in the more centralized infrastructure on the MK directory before they go live. So Tinderbox was a package build tool written in PHP, and before the current package build tool Poudrière came around in 2011, which is written in shell. It was run on decentralized hardware, which all managed by volunteers, so basically it's people's home boxes or spare box at the office, and which had an interesting side effect that hard disk would just randomly wear out and they had to be replaced, and so the node, that build node, was not available for a while. But today, all packages are built inside of the FreeBSD cluster, because Poudrière makes use of the multi-core nature of modern servers. So you have one package built on one core generally, so you can build 30 packages or so at once. Well, yeah, so because the Porsche tree has been around since 94, well, back in the day, if you want to do a repository copy, which you would want to do because we want to preserve history at all times. And so you couldn't do that with CVS, and you can't do that with Git either, which we use nowadays. But the idea was to, if you have a certain port, say GC2, and you want to make a GC3 port, and GC2 is still alive, so you want to preserve that branch, and GC3 goes its own way. So you copy everything, the history of GC2 into GC3, and then they go independent. But there was, since there was no CVS copy command, you would have to ask the repository meisters to do that for you, and they would fiddle inside the CVS service to mimic a copy, and then they would go back to you and say, yeah, it's done. And with Subversion, you could just natively type SVN copy, and it was fine. And with Git, they, because of the nature of Git, it doesn't exist, which is kind of sad. The other thing was that sometimes the entire port tree would have to be locked. For example, when a new FreeBSD release was about to be done, so that you would have a consistent package state. Or if you would import a new version of GNOME or KDE or Xorg. So someone for port manager would just flip some bit on the server, I think. And then nobody could CVS commit or SVN commit. And then, well, when once that update was done and people were confident that it was okay, then the tree would be unlocked again. There were no quarterly branches, which we use currently a lot. So there was just the port tree was just the tip of CVS, or what we call head nowadays, or main. We had the main branch, and then you would just live from that. And in 2014 we introduced quarterly branches. So the idea of those is that at the start of each quarter you make a copy of the main branch, and all security and critical bug fixes go in there, and including new browser versions, because browsers are special and they have no backports. And all the more fast-paced stuff goes into main. So those changes only go into the next quarterly. And each quarterly branch also lives for one quarter. So so we're now at 2021 Q3, and in 2 weeks it will be 2021 Q4, and Q3 will be end of life. We use quarterly branches to build packages for everything except FreeBSD current. So FreeBSD current uses the main branch, and all releases use a quarterly branch by default. But in the time there were no pre-built packages except those that were shipped on the release CD. So that meant that if you'd install FreeBSD 4.6 and you get GNOME running and you need an update for GNOME because of some security issue or bug or whatever, you would just have to build those updates on your own machine, or maybe some local centralized thing. And yourself, so there was no way to type package update, which we do now. And just hope everything was fine. And there was also no license framework, which was introduced by Thomas Apthorpe. So the idea of that is that for each port you can specify which license or licenses it's shipped under. And you can actually say, I want GPL2 is fine, but GPL3 is not, or I want BSD license stuff, Whatever. So Daredevil swore that the general history and reports themselves that there existed no concept of staging, which meant that if you would build an update for a GNOME package, basically you would just do configure and then make install, but that was abstracted away in just typing make install the port. But that also meant that the make install would actually fiddle with your live system. So if there was a bug in the package list or the port was broken, then your live system was also inconsistent. So in, not sure, 2015-ish, Baptiste Sen, who's still port manager, he came up with the idea of staging, which you also see a lot in the Linux world. So the idea is that the port does its make install, but it doesn't do it on live system, but on a temporary copy of a clean live system. So you can and the port framework can see if which files are installed and if that matches the list of files you supposed to install. And if there are files missing or extra files or maybe permissions are different, and it can inform that ports develop of that. And then if everything's fine and you know what you're going to install, so you can safely install the package on your live system. There was also no users, for example, which is a convenient method to say, like, this port installs a kernel module, so you say in the ports make file users as kmod, and then it automatically pulls in some boilerplate that is useful for ports that install kernel models. So, for example, to see if you have the source tree installed or there's some compiler flags. You can also say use that for users as GNOME, and then yeah, so I want these components of GNOME installed, and I can put that in the users or like over 100. Well, nowadays I think there are over 100 very different users, which are all listed in the Porter's handbook. So there were also no flavors, which meant that if you build a port, you get tiny variations of the port. So if you have an office, like LibreOffice, and you want to print stuff because that's what you do in an office, you can specify if you want A4 or letter sized paper. And then you can just tell that to the ports, like, I have a package of LibreOffice which produces A4 output or a package that produces letter size output, and you don't need two different ports for that, with just a tiny variation. Or another flavor would be like if you use Qt versus GTK as a graphical framework, or so, yeah. So, yeah, and in the beginning, ports were much more imperative, the make files instead of declarative. So, you just, now nowadays, you do specify things, variables and behavioral things that you want the port to be, and you don't write much extra commands in the port itself. Most of that code is abstracted away in the make framework and in those users or related places, which is actually a lot easier to read, in my opinion. So we also make policies. One is so we have a charter which is governed by the core team, which you can read at the specified link, and Port Manager turned that into a set of policies, which is basically a charter with fleshed out. And the policy, it's about how to build packages and that we should document things in the ports handbook, for example, that the ports framework and individual ports, to keep an eye on security. So, and legal aspects that, those are there in between, but occasionally we do get a question about licenses. But I think the last one was probably a year ago, so we look at the overall direction of the port tree, though the things I mentioned on the previous few slides. And well, yeah, because we're all people and people sometimes disagree, we try to update between people and look if there's a common solution that everyone can live with. Now, one of the other tasks of Port Manager is to build packages. So those are automated for the main and the quarterly branches. As mentioned earlier, the main packages are built for the previously current, and the quarterly are built for all releases. But you can, of course, just build packages from the main branch of the port tree for your release if you want, or the other way around. And they might also. So that happens for all JR1 and JR2 architectures. JR1 typically being ARM64, AMD64, and i386. And JR2 being the smaller ARM, v6, v7. RISC-V, something, probably. Depending on availability, packages should be, updates should be built multiple times a week. So that you, that also bug fixes and security fixes, only just a few days behind, and you can just type package upgrade and you get the latest fixes. So, well, actually Port Manager is just a lot more people than me. So we have Adam Weinberger, actually does a lot of the human resources kind of thing. So Not as a hiring manager, but he actually, tries to deal with the human issues Like if there are questions or people tend to disagree about something or and yeah. He mostly steps in. Antoine Baudin, he's responsible for building packages and maintaining the configuration of the package building cluster. And he also does experimental runs. So if you want a new version of CMake, which can affect a lot of other packages, you first do a full run, but instead of releasing the packages built in that run, you just see if which other packages would break or not, and if it's fine, then you can actually push the update so that the new CMake version goes live. So Baptiste Ossani is responsible for the package tool and the framework, and he's also the liaison for the core team. And Brian Drury is also involved in package building, the package building tool, Boudier, and he's the liaison for the release engineering team. Mathieu Arnault is involved in the framework and maintained the Porter's handbook. He's a liaison for cluster admin, the cluster administration team, which like the system administrators. René Ladan, that's me, secretary for the ports team, which means publishing the monthly reports that goes to the previously developers and writing an entry for the quarterly reports, which are public. Also, involve it, like if people introduce a new candidate as a new if people introduce a new candidate for a board developer, what is it on the slide? I'm missing a piece here. Well, another thing is committers, they post developers, they sometimes become inactive for various reasons. And I run a monthly script that checks if people are still active. Depending on the results, they're taken there. I'm stuck. So if people become too inactive, the policy is to disable the commit privileges, which just means that there's a file which says if you can actually technically make a commit and you're just removed from the file, but it's not a ban. So you're not banned from the community or anything, but it's just more like a safety measure. And I also tend to clean up a lot of ports, like expired ports or like the upcoming end of life of FreeBSD 11. Then clean up you've got kind of cleanups in force for workarounds that are no longer necessary. And Steve Wills, he does all kind of miscellaneous things, and we also occasionally have trainees, which we call lurkers, and Tobias Berner is currently one of them. And, well, since Boardmanship also has a lot of alumni, you can look them up in the below link. And so we also interact with other teams. So accounts. The accounts team is, maintain accounts for, your freebies, the address and access to various servers. And those are also the people that you, that we inform if there's a new candidate coming. Because in FreeBSD, the model is more by invitation. So if you're a volunteer and you do a lot of course work or documentation or kernel work, and someone notices that, then the typical procedure is that you get a question like, do you want to be a developer yourself? And if you agree, then for Ports Manager, so if you're working on a lot of ports, you send the existing developer sends a mail to Ports Manager and we vote on the new candidate, and usually it's fine. The new candidate is welcomed as a new developer. At which time, the first few months or changes they get actually get must be approved by the new by the one who volunteered to bring the new candidate in as a kind of mentor. And if people retire, then they also inform accounts and the core team. So for cluster administration team, occasionally talk to them, mostly for if you need more package builders. And the release engineering team, if a new release comes up, they want to see if you're on the same page with the packages that go in that are built for that release, so that's tend to be a specific commit of the port stream that gets picked based on how stable the port stream is and how far the release process of the previous version is. We inform core about new committers and committers that retire. And also, the core team is a group of FreeBSD developers that gets elected every 2 years by the active FreeBSD developers, which basically means you made a change to one of the source trees in the last year. And so they're the internal representation of the FreeBSD project. A bit of the internal board of directors, and if FreeBSD was a company. And then above that, the core team is the FreeBSD Foundation, which is technically not part of the FreeBSD project, but they exist for the FreeBSD project. And they typically deal with a lot of intellectual property and legal entities and promote the FreeBSD project and on various conferences and well, can read about them at their page, their website freebsdfoundation.org. And so the core team also communicates downwards with various teams that kind of delegates, such as board manager or the graphics teams or security team or the documentation engineering team. So they're kind of the central team. So as she said, this also me also a personal maybe also involved with personal stuff such as well voting on new committers and their mentors. Because well mostly so if an existing developer propose a new candidate and we think, oh, the candidate is fine, and we also check to see if the one who proposed the candidate would be the mentor. It's usually fine, but we prefer to have two mentors per candidate for things like time zones or availability. If people are idle for too long, kind of safe keep their commitments, which usually just means that cannot technically do a make commit, or which is nowadays Git push. But now if you have time again, or interest in returning, can just write a mail to board manager and they're happy to welcome you back. And so we just sent a mail to the core and accounts team that you have returned. Board manager itself also changes over time because people decide to not this. They want to do all the things, or maybe just be a regular FreeBSD committer, or maybe retire from FreeBSD entirely, or whatever. We sometimes need new people. So van based, you just ask them. And another way is with a Lurker program where volunteers can sign up. And the original idea was that you were Lurker for 2 months and then you would either stay or, just not be a Lurker anymore. So you were back to a regular developer, but that's currently a bit it needs to be restarted a bit. And since boards match as people and people are not perfect, one way is that communication could be better. We dabbled a bit with Twitter and Facebook, but a few years ago, but it was a lot of high maintenance. Also because a lot of updates were already in the already announced in on the mailing list, for example. It was a bit deciding what to what to put on the social media and what not. And yeah, there wasn't a real benefit in our opinion. Also because on Twitter, for example, we have the FreeBSD help account, which publishes kind of FreeBSD news and helps people. Another idea was to split off into some new teams so that both that other interested people could help with that part and to kind of get the load. Like one example, package manager, which is currently done by port manager, but it could also be that a few people that are actually building packages combined with perhaps people from cluster administration or release engineering, that you have a more focused view, but that just never happened. And maybe there's other ways to reorganize. So yeah, that would be it for now. If there's any questions.
So thank you, René, for your presentation. Any questions?
Yeah, I got a bit of a blackout at one point.
yes, but well, anyway, it got through. So any questions from the audience? You can write the questions on the public chat.
Oh, yes, maybe on IRC too. That'd be nice to check. Nothing on the Dev Summit.
If not, I think we can close here and you can stay on chat, and if anyone answers and asks anything, you can answer them.
No?
Okay. Thank you very much. Enjoy the conference. And this is it. After this will come the lunch break, and then will come the next session. Thank you, everyone. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye. There's a question on the chat here. How do we think young people who are starting with programming can be involved one way or another? The way I got in myself in 2010 or so, when I started dabbling with ports. I was just using FreeBSD on my laptop as a daily driver, basically, and picked up maintenance of a few ports. As was every port has a maintainer line, and the maintainer is kind of the first line of contact. So you're the caretaker of the port, but not like the absolute I'll put that nicely. You're not the sole governor of that port. So ports is a bit, well, you're basically just writing a kind of a recipe, like this port. Well, it's about a calculator, and it needs these dependencies, and there's a nice some examples in the handbook. So it's just not just really programming as in writing a program, but depending how many patches the ports need, like the Chromium port, which was the presentation about yesterday, which uses around 1,000 patches, which is kind of the exception. There you change source files to so that the port works on FreeBSD. Yeah, so how you get involved? So one way is just using FreeBSD and ports, or their binding package versions to daily driver, and then or get involved into community in general. Access the ports, FreeBSD ports at FreeBSD.org main list. It's also a bit of a larger community question. How do you get involved with FreeBSD? I guess which is one of the things that the FreeBSD Foundation is about. So the follow-up comment is that they are currently looking at Microsoft technologies and Java. That would be more C sharp, I think, in Europe, but anyway. You can use Java and C sharp and FreeBSD. How you can evolve there? It's actually a good question, but I don't have a ready-made answer. This is, I think, about some intrinsic interests. Or people get involved by their employer because they work on a project, or like you have some in the Bay system, we have some people work on various drivers, network drivers, for example, because the company needs that to work. Working on a project is a good way. That's one way. I basically just, for myself, I run FreeBSD mostly, almost exclusively as a, at home, as a hobby. There's no, barely any professional, use for me of FreeBSD. Another follow-up comment from Luna is writing package build files for stuff that you think is missing and help update build files that needs updating. Yes, so you can also improve existing ports, of course. For example, features that could be missing. not that they're not perhaps not working properly. So in general, you can send in a problem report in Bugzilla at bugs.freebc.org and then write a patch. Yeah, but what Mark says, writing and fixing, reporting, fixing bug works very well. And yeah, that's just do something you like. You mean a tool as in yeah, some software package, I guess, that you like. An office tool or a network filter or anything. Yeah, I mean, yeah, so another way might be, but I think that's more aimed towards the kernel, which you typically see in operating system classes at universities. Yeah, I get an introduction to the FreeBSD kernel that you use as a or the Linux kernel or whatever. So an actual instance of this abstract thing that you just discussed for the last N weeks. But more related to kernel work, of course. Not necessarily to a ports work, which is mostly about third party packages. We have like 8 minutes left, I think, before the video gets cut off. 12. Nothing on IRC, right? More thank you notes. You're welcome. Actually, the first problem report I submitted was for some toy compiler I wrote as a student. And about 18 years ago, I thought it was cool if FreeBSD had that too. And then, it actually made it into the port stream. It's still in, because even though it hasn't been updated in ages. So that's another way to, yeah. And you can fix an existing patches or bring in new patches. So we have various teams also, so joining them for KDE or GNOME or X11, which is also known as the graphics team because they do the low level It's definitely valent kind of things. Yeah, the Chromium team. So Joni, those one of those teams. It's not a way to get involved. Yeah, so for example, well, yeah, it's not really related to ports. But if, in more general, if you like to write documentation or translate documentation into your local language, then that's another way to get involved with FreeBSD. Which is how I actually joined the FreeBSD developer team. So by my first contributions were just translating English documentation to Dutch, into the Dutch language, which was a few other people back in the day. Well, yeah, I think thank you all for attending and get some lunch myself.